It glows with red light where light should not exist. It thrives where fragile bodies are crushed, where giant forms should not endure. Science says it should not be alive, yet here it is, proof that the oceans guard secrets not just unexplored, but seemingly impossible. And what allows such an anomaly to exist when nothing else should? Above the abyss, sunlight pours through the uppermost 200 meters, the epipelagic, the sunlight zone. Here, water glows with shifting blues and greens, warm and alive with energy. But as depth increases, that brilliance fades. By 200 meters, only a faint blue shimmer remains. At 1,000 meters, the world enters the mesopelagic, the twilight zone. Light drops to a fraction of a percent, shadows thicken, and colors vanish. Red and yellow wavelengths disappear first, leaving only the deepest blue. Temperatures fall sharply, and pressure mounts, every 10 meters adding another atmosphere, until the weight above is measured in hundreds of tons. Below 1,000 meters, the midnight zone begins. Here, at depths reaching 4,000 meters, sunlight is gone entirely. The water is nearly freezing, just above 0 degrees Celsius. No dawn, no dusk, only endless night. Vision becomes useless for most life. Eyes shrink or vanish. Instead, some animals generate their own light, brief flashes of bioluminescence cutting through the black. In these depths, the rules of survival change. Every adaptation is shaped by darkness, by cold, by a pressure that would flatten steel. Each layer, sunlight, twilight, midnight, marks a boundary not just of light, but of possibility. And yet, life persists, adapting in ways that seem almost impossible. The deeper the descent, the more alien the world becomes, and the more the ocean guards its secrets. Beneath 4,000 meters, the ocean enters its most forbidding realms. The abyssal zone stretches from 4,000 to 6,000 meters, a world where the seafloor lies shrouded in perpetual blackness. Here, the water presses with a weight few materials can withstand, over 400 times what we feel at the surface. Temperatures hover just above freezing, and the silence is broken only by the distant groan of shifting tectonic plates. Life is sparse, scattered across endless plains of fine sediment and the occasional volcanic vent. Most creatures shrink or flatten, their bodies soft, boneless, and strange, built to yield rather than resist. The remains of sunlight, warmth, and color are long gone. Beyond 6,000 meters, trenches open into the Hadal zone. These are the deepest scars on Earth, plunging to nearly 11,000 meters in places. At these depths, pressure climbs past 1,000 atmospheres. It is a force that can crush steel, deform glass, and collapse all but the most specialized life. Only a handful of animals have ever been found here. Tiny amphipods, ghostly sea cucumbers, and the rarest of fish. Their existence is balanced on a knife's edge. Every cell shaped by the need to survive in a world where water itself becomes heavy as stone. The abyssal and Hadal zones are not just remote. They are almost alien, their boundaries defined by the absolute limits of endurance. Yet even here, life persists, clinging to the edges of what is possible. Light here is not a gift from above, but a chemical invention, born in darkness and shaped by necessity. In the mesopelagic and midnight zones, many animals possess organs called photophores, each a tiny factory where molecules such as luciferin react with oxygen, releasing blue or green light. Blue and green are the most efficient colors for underwater travel, cutting through seawater's dense filter like a faint lighthouse in black water. Yet, in rare cases, the chemistry bends the rules. The black dragonfish, Malacosteus, crafts not only blue, but deep red beams that are invisible to most eyes in the ocean. Its photophores contain layered filters and fluorescent pigments that shift the wavelength far beyond the reach of ordinary vision. This red light becomes a secret signal, an evolutionary trick that lets Malacosteus hunt unseen, its prey illuminated in a spectrum only it can perceive. But light is only half the equation. The deeper the descent, the greater the challenge for molecules themselves. At 6,000 meters, pressure climbs to 600 times that at the surface. Proteins and membranes face collapse unless reinforced by special biochemicals. Hadal amphipods, for example, fill their cells with the molecule trimethylamine N-oxide, known as TMAO, a piezolite that stabilizes cellular machinery under crushing force. The concentration of TMAO rises with depth, reaching a chemical ceiling in the trenches, and that protection comes at a price. Energy spent on defense rather than growth or speed. Even the smallest miscalculation means disaster at these depths. Together, light and chemistry set the boundaries of survival. Bioluminescence must function under immense pressure, and pressure adaptations must not interfere with the fragile reactions that make light possible. Each solution is a compromise, a delicate balance struck at the very edge of what life can endure. These are the rules of the deep, and when a creature bends them, it forces us to ask how far evolution can push the limits of the possible. Transparency in the deep sea is a feat of physics as much as biology. To vanish in water, an animal's tissues must match the refractive index of seawater almost perfectly within a few thousandths. The glass octopus, drifting at depths near 1,000 meters, achieves this by building its body from nearly pure gel. 99% water, the rest a fine lattice of collagen and mucopolysaccharides. Muscles are sparse, pigment nearly absent, and even the few visible organs are tucked away, shielded from prying eyes. This approach works in the upper bathypelagic, where pressure is high but not yet overwhelming, and where being unseen means survival. But as depth increases, the trade-offs sharpen. Below 2,000 meters, true transparency becomes rare. The pressure compacts tissues, squeezing water from the gel and raising the protein density. Even a slight mismatch in refractive index turns an invisible animal into a faint, ghostly outline, enough for a predator to spot. At these depths, most creatures abandon transparency for sturdier forms, their bodies thickening, their tissues darkening. Large size brings its own problems. As an animal grows, its mass demands more robust support, more muscle, more energy. The glass octopus, for all its elegance, remains small and fragile. Gigantism in the deep sea, seen in creatures like the giant isopod or the colossal squid, favors bulk and resilience over delicacy. The metabolic scaling laws are unforgiving. Doubling in size means far more than doubling the strength needed to keep a body intact under pressure. To be both large and transparent is to balance on a razor's edge, where the slightest slip means structural collapse or sudden visibility. In the Abyss and Hadal zones, no known animal manages this balance for long. The physics of light, water, and flesh seem to rule it out. A creature drifts into the frame, its outline almost erased by the water itself. Massive, yet almost invisible, its body bends the rules of optics. Its tissue and gelatinous layers are so finely matched to the surrounding sea that light glides through, leaving only a ghostly shimmer. A soft, mysterious score swells. Along its length, sudden bursts of patterned light pulse in deep red and blue, a living code written in wavelengths no other animal at these depths can see or produce. Beneath that transparent surface, complex organs flicker into view and then vanish, as if the animal chooses what to reveal and what to hide. The effect reads like a living signal, private and precise. Its motion is impossibly fluid for something so large. It undulates with a speed and control unknown among the slow giants of the abyss. The movement cuts through the water with the grace of a much smaller predator, an eerie calm masking enormous power. Every trait on display, its scale, its clarity, its luminous signals, contradicts the limits set by crushing pressure, finite energy budgets, and the slow pace of evolution. These are constraints that shape life in the deep, constraints this animal appears to defy. For a moment, the laws of biology seem suspended, and the impossible swims before the camera. The evidence on film is stark, a paradox recorded in light and shadow, and it forces a question we were not prepared to answer. The ocean still hides mysteries that unsettle our models, and we have only just begun to look. Deep in the crushing dark, the camera finds the creature, already there, moving as if light itself avoids its shape. Remotely operated vehicles descend with high-definition cameras, capturing movement and the smallest flashes of bioluminescence that no human eye could witness in person. Even the best cameras struggle to track an animal whose body bends light and erases its own outline. Pressure chambers built to bring living specimens to the surface intact rarely succeed, and most delicate forms collapse or dissolve when the weight above them lifts. For now, much of what we know comes from brief flickering glimpses and fragments caught in the water column. Genomic sequencing offers a path forward, but samples are rare and often damaged beyond analysis. Every observation is shaped by the limits of our tools, leaving wide gaps where the creature's biology and origin remain hidden. The paradox grows. The more extraordinary the evidence becomes, the less science can explain. These are the hard truths of working at the edge of exploration. Machines endure the pressure and the cold, and still the ocean keeps some of its secrets. The evidence is real, and it is incomplete, and the questions it raises are larger than our instruments. Today, over 80% of our oceans remain uncharted. Each unmapped trench hides life that rewrites biology's rules. As exploration advances, every new discovery forces us to confront how little we know. The deepest mysteries are not behind us. They wait, in darkness, still beyond our reach.